Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back to another StockTwits Q&A session. We're going to be answering your questions live. I'm your host, Brittany Umar. I'm going to be joined by Scott Red Dog Redler in just a minute. But first, we're going to show you a quick video, give you a glimpse into a day in the life of a trader. Check this out.
I'm in a little MGM and I'm still in OIH. I bought it this morning at 107.50.
Apple's good.
You don't buy in the first 5 minutes of the day.
I live in Jersey City. I was born in Long Island, went to school at SUNY Albany.
As a firm, we are 5 partners and I'm one of them. I am the strategist that puts the game plan together for about 400 traders. I kind of command that army.
It's going to make us money with that. Is on a day like today, if it's up or down 3 handles, that's when you see where other money is really getting put to work, and that's where the action is.
You held 1,600 the whole time?
I got 1,000.
See, that's a growing experience for you, brother.
All the traders trade our money, so they have to be right. They have to say, okay, I think Apple's going from 260 to 265, and if they're right, they make money.
It's a good setup. Stick with the win.
Okay.
It's the right trade. Don't watch it so close. Relax.
Scott's coming on in a minute, so we're going to listen to Scott.
Scott, technicals first. Market looks good. Volume seems a little light. What do you see?
Right now, the market's behaving very well technically.
Let's talk to this guy. Now, here's a guy, Scott Redler, who does nothing but technical analysis, but puts his money where his mouth is because he's got a firm and his partners put their money in every day and trade on technical analysis.
I'm not looking for a home run. It's not a get-rich-quick scheme. If I'm able to pick the direction of the market, I could book a winning trade and I could provide for my family.
MERS breakout.
That is the next evolution.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Thursday's Q&A with myself and Brittany. We are here today, and it's a very exciting day. I know we took off last week, which I apologize for, but you know, it's vacation, and we all have to go do what we got to do. But we're back, and with the way the markets reacted today and with the amount of questions we're getting coming in second by second, I just think that we got to get going. So, Brittany, could you just do what you do best?
Let's take it away. We'll answer Eleanor Rigby first.
Hi,
who
I'm
says,
Sean
Red
Hendelman.
Dog, kindly explain your process of taking the market's temperature and how you know a particular stock will make a bullish move the day of.
Taking the market's temperature is a kind of weird visual, isn't it? But but we say that because sometimes you know, the market's hot, sometimes it's cold, sometimes it's lukewarm. So, you know, in the morning call, we like to check the temperature, sometimes on a Monday, of where we are for the week, what sectors are acting well, what sectors are acting weak, where the strength is. So when we say check the temperature, we want to see like how things are acting. What's the composure like? Where are things going? Where should we look to? And what that does is helps us formulate our game plan. Because that's what we have. Every day we have a game plan because we only have, you know, 10 fingers and 2 eyeballs. And you know, I have 6 to, how many screens do I have? I have 6 and you might only have 2. So you need to know what stocks you're going to be looking at, you know, and you want to do it because you want to do it with the hot sector. So you want to make sure that the temperature is right. So with that said, you know, if you want to get into, what was the second part of the question?
How you know a particular stock will make a bullish move the day of.
Oh, well, that's a whole nother different story. That depends on what the market's actually doing, depends on if it's in a hot sector, depends on if it's a leadership role or a leader stock or a stock you're just looking to, you know, play some kind of catch-up laggard cash flow play. So there's a lot going on. So first thing, I want to talk about the temperature of the market of the S&P, and I want to show you what happened today and what you could have seen on a technical level and what you hopefully got involved in if you watch the morning call and you're involved in our T3 Live community. So you go to the chart of the S&P or the SPX, and you will see exactly what happened today. All right, first of all, you know, it doesn't really get much better than that right here. Look at this clean breakout, clean to the upside. Technicians, market strategists, traders love tight patterns. They love when everyone gets worn out because once you constrict so tight, that's when you get a breakout move. Now, if you remember the June 4th low that we've been talking about, we've been in this methodical uptrend ever since. And, you know, we've tested it a few times right around here. It got a little choppy before Draghi started to jawbone. And really, it's been pretty methodical and maneuverable the entire way. And then most recently, you know, if you guys remember on August 3rd, that jobs report that came out, we accelerated right here to the upside. And we had a nice run in August, which was very surprising. And within that run, we saw a lot of leaders flex their muscles. There was a lot of great stock selection ideas that we'll get into later in the show. But it was really a nice move, a move where we went back to a portfolio approach. And then finally, you know, we got back to the highs, right? Remember this breakout failure when we pushed through 1422 and we couldn't get any momentum and we came back in. And that was a time to get away from the little portfolio approach and get back into a little bit more flexible. What's going to happen? Can we hold up here? Can we go sideways and absorb what has been a sizable move since the lows? Then lo and behold, today we had an event. Now it feels like every day the market wants to obsess over events. And, you know, we talk about last week was Jackson Hole, you know, on what was it, on Friday. And Big Ben didn't come out with anything so blockbuster. You know, he was same statement, same accommodative. He went out another year, you know, and they tried to sell off the market. And what happened? 1395 to 1398 held. What happened? You go back to the chart, you look at the support that, you know what, technicians were trading against. We didn't have opinions. We didn't talk about trying to be so smart and say, what did really he say? What does this mean in the next 3 months, 6 months, 9 months? We said, no, you know what? We held this area, so we have to look at the market from a constructive basis. And then today, you know, Draghi came out. We talked, I think we had like two or three different morning calls. And, you know, he came out with statements and we tweeted right away saying, this is what we liked, what we heard. Okay. We talked about accountability. That's something we always talk about. And he said that if you're going to get money, that you have to have some restrictions for it. You just can't go and start partying and go, you know, wherever you're going or whatever. These sovereign nations that have been playing by no sets of rules and got themselves in trouble, it wouldn't have been good if they said, okay, we're just going to buy your bonds and you keep spending the way you want to spend it. So that was the whole accountability. That was the whole with, you know, conditionality. Remember the big tweet this morning with conditionality? I was like, wow, that's good. That's what I wanted to hear. Street also wanted to hear, you know, sterilize, which means that they just can't print to, you know, to the cows come home. They have to like take from one place and from another and not expand their balance sheet too much. But anyway, I'm not that smart to talk about that in specifics. But all we knew, again, as a technician, 1413 to 1415 is a level if we get above. And if, you know, you're a short and you've been rolling it up since the June 4th lows or rolling it up since the past October lows, you're going to get worried. And if you were a bull or you were just a market participant that wanted to catch a move that could take us into the end of the year, that's a level that we can cross. So if you go back to the chart, two important things. One, boom, the support that held. And then look at this nice tight range. So right off the bat, you didn't even have to have excessive risk going into the Draghi ECB event today. You know, I had, I think, five or six longs, one short. It really, once we went above that 1413, that was your spot to start getting involved. And if you had a plan and if you had your go-to list and you had your strong stocks, you were able to grab them. And then what happened? Boom, we broke out. We just cleared this massive resistance on day one. So typically with day one, you can get more. I know we have the jobs report tomorrow, but I think, you know, you could stay with a portfolio approach. And at this particular point, what do we close at 1432? I think my objective that I put, I think in August, saying I think that realistically we can get to 1450 to 1470, it might actually be a little bit higher.
Oh, okay. So touching on that, then Market Picker has a question. Does today's resolution to the upside above post-crisis highs in the SPX spell higher prices for the generally seasonally bullish fourth quarter?
I think it does. You know, I think a lot of shorts covered today. Some new money maybe came in. I think even some new money still said, oh, I'm not getting involved. This is, you know, stimulus. It's on hopium. It's on thisium. It's on thatium. You know what? The prices don't lie. And if you got involved and you were long and you booked your profits, they can't come take it away. So meanwhile, you know, this wide range bar breakout to me opened the door to that 1450, 1470. And I think longer term, you know, I've been talking about, you know, a longer term thesis, and I know it's not exactly the way I go about my daily business, but I've been saying, I think in 2015, which we posted on our blog, and we've been saying in the media, in Bloomberg, CNBC, whatever, I think we see S&P 1700. Now, I'm not a permabull, and I do like to get short, and I do trade the ranges, but I'm looking at the macro charts, and the macro charts to me are saying I think we've had this 12-year base in the S&P, and we've absorbed a ton of bad news, and I think we're going to get to that 1700. So the reason why I say it is I think everyone should have a macro plan, have some kind of 401k, put money every month into an S&P, you know, do it every single month, and I think you'll make money. Have a 529 if you have kids. and just do that. It's better than sitting cash in the bank. I think that you're going to get rewarded, and you have to have that macro plan. And also in the macro plan, we also talk about, you know, macro investment quality stocks, stocks that are above moving averages, that have innovative products, that grow their revenues, grow their net income. And those are things you could hold as a stock picker. So macro plan, stock pickers, you see stocks at historic highs, you know, both things together could make you money. And then our sweet spot, or at least mine, is I like to trade the intermediate trends when a trend is up, because we've had probably about 20 little intermediate trends in the last decade, and you could have made a lot of money long and short. I think there's like an interesting stat saying we've had about 310% of movement in the last decade, but I've gone nowhere. That means we've gone up 10%, down 5%, up 15%, down 60%, and that is our sweet spot, and we figure out how to navigate that. But at this, you know, moment, that intermediate trend is continuing to the upside. We're going to ride it, and we'll take off positions. We'll use our tier system. We'll trade around stocks and the best acting ones, and we'll also have a hedge on just in case some news comes out and we have a little bit of protection, so then we could, you know, maneuver that, and I was talking about that in the chat room today.
Well, speaking of having a macro plan and your belief that will go so much higher, let's answer PNA, who's asking, should macro S&P holders for long term hold, add, or sell some here?
Macro? Well, it depends on what age you are. If you're like our age, you hold. Like, you're in a macro plan, this is a retirement. This is something that you're going to have for 20 years. This is something you want to put in every single month. Like, my wife, I think she's 36. She started when she's 29. She puts it every single month, you know, and the company matches it. If you have that kind of capabilities, or, you know, company that does that can do that and keep doing that. Same thing, 529, boom. You don't take that out until the kid goes to college. That's different. That's macro. You want to go to the S&P 500 or the chart again? Let's go. S&P, chart. Here we go. We go to the monthly, because this is different time frames, okay? I want to talk about two things that have happened. First of all, it's amazing how everyone hates the stock market, and we're up now about 13% in the S&P and a lot more in the NASDAQ. You want to take a more broad stroke, actually read the Wall Street Journal, because we talked about this day back on October 4th. This was an outside day. This was a day, remember that day when everything changed last fall? We're not even a year from that, and we're probably from this point, what's 1,100 to 1,400, who knows, that's probably something like 30% off the lows with a lot of, you know, a lot going on in the middle, a lot of Fibonacci rules, a lot of retracement rules, a lot of tier system, a lot of things that we go over in our active trading class, our momentum trading class, and maybe our new swing trading class that's coming up. You know, here you go, just real quickly, a little pattern anatomy here, outside day, right? And then we wedged, broke out of the wedge. Then you had your portfolio approach. Remember that portfolio approach in the first quarter? Then what do we have here? That head and shoulders top, left shoulder, head, right shoulder. Could have saved yourself some nice pain right there as it then, you know, put a measured move down to right around here, right? Remember that? So here you go, you know, outside day, wedge, portfolio approach, lighten up, outside day, get back involved, and now we're continuing higher. Now go back to your macro question to the monthly, you know, look where we are right now. We are still in a series of higher lows and higher highs. What is this here? Look at that, from the crisis of 2008. What do we have? An outside day or an outside month. So these type of patterns repeat themselves on daily, weekly, monthly, 5 minute, 15 minute, 60 minute, 30 minute, you name it. You know, they repeat themselves. That's why we talk about it so much. So here you go right there. That's your outside month to switch gears after a big decline. But anyway, here's your low, higher low, higher low, higher low. Here's a high, higher high, higher high. And now we're in the process of taking out this higher high. So technically, to me, that's really good, right? Higher high, we can continue. Now it looks to me that you have 1440, right, which is a point of interest, which we're right there. Then you have 1471. So that's where I got my target, you know, first things first for this year. Okay, here's your 1470 and here's your 1440. And this was before we broke out. Okay, this was before, you know, the I talked about it on CNBC Asia last night, before Draghi said what he did. So that's a point of reference, that's an area, but that looks really close. You know, we're only in September, who knows, it could even go more than that. And then if we do, your next big point of reference here is this double top. Double tops are very bearish. You know, look what the double top led to. Here's your high, double top, bam. Okay, so when double tops get taken out, it's very bullish. So this high area comes into fruition right around 1576. So you know, there's a lot to like going on, a lot of participation in a lot of sectors, and those with an equity plan are going to make money, and those that are still out there that are naysayers, that are pessimistic, that, you know, equities are dead. You know, I think I see Bill Gross everywhere. Rubini's at cocktail parties still trying to act cool. I won't talk about who's on Twitter, always tweeting about, you know, the death of equities, and, you know, only morons and momentum guys are looking at stocks, whatever. It's not true. Educate yourselves. There's a lot of money out there, and I think there's going to be a lot of money coming up.
All right. Well, we are just getting warmed up here. Keep your questions coming. We're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be joined by Evan Lazarus.
Hi, I'm Sean Hendelman of T3 Live, where we train, coach, and mentor traders in order to help you put your money to work with confidence. The T3 Live approach is a blueprint for you to recognize, adapt, and ultimately take advantage of different market conditions. To begin your training with T3 Live, we would like to offer you the opportunity to enroll in our free 30-day online home study course. Fill in your name and email address, and I'll see you on the other side.
We're back, and we're answering your questions live. Now we're joined by Laz. Laz, welcome to the segment.
Well, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Let's dive right in and answer Prof here, who says, how does a non-pro swing trader like me with a regular job deal with fluctuations that extended market hours traders create?
Well, you know, generally the rule of thumb is with post-market trading, pre-market or after-market hours, when there's not a liquid marketplace, it's not. I don't give a lot of credibility to a marketplace that doesn't have the liquidity. So, when you say how do I deal with a pre or post-market trading, well, my question is: if you're a novice trader, you probably shouldn't be worrying about what happens in the pre or the post-market. And if you're swing trading, again, stick to your time frame, stick to your daily charts. If something changes overnight that dramatically affects the structure of the chart you're trading or your position, then it's time to implement, you know, exit strategies or you know, appropriate strategies. But I don't think that, you know, it's something that you need to lose a lot of sleep over. And I'm trying to answer this question the best I can without really knowing what you do or how you do it. In a general sense, you know, the way I talk to traders in the active trader program about the pre and the post market is that I generally avoid it unless there's heavy liquidity. A news-driven event or an earnings-driven or something, some sort of catalyst that says, you know, something has changed and changed for the better or for the worse. And at such point, how has it affected, you know, what my trade is or was and what do I do now? How do I, you know, maneuver because of it? So, you know, when you say I'm a novice and I'm swing trading, you know, my question is, you know, are you prepared for, you know, do you understand the risk associated with all your trades? You know, the one thing that we all practice and preach here is risk, understanding the risk. And, you know, if something changes in the pre-market, you know, you should have a plan in place that allows you to maneuver, both for the better, you know, and sometimes for the worse.
All right, here's one from Jenny the Trader for you saying, what do you think of First Solar, a good short targeting 15-16?
Well, First Solar, we can look at the chart here. It's one of these stocks that, you know, had a great story for a very long time. And you've seen this, you know, over and over again with various stocks in various sectors. This is a monthly chart of First Solar. So I'm basically giving you, you know, from 2007 to today. You know, this is a broken chart with a broken story that really just doesn't have the interest and attention that it once had. Now, that being said, you know, if we drill down and we look at the daily chart, you know, what's happening here and now, I probably wouldn't be that aggressive on the short side. It's still a broken chart. It still doesn't have any buyers. It still doesn't have, you know, it still doesn't even from a pattern perspective, you know, there's not a lot here that jumps off the screen that says this is a screaming long. Think about what the market looks like even today and what this stock looks like. So yes, I can understand your question about a short, but at this point, you know, based on larger time frames, you know, this is probably a stock that's you know, it might go lower, it might go back to the lows, but in all honesty, we're back at where the IPO was, even lower. This is probably going to give you a very long sideways basing, you know, type action. You might see, you know, some sort of sideways base that goes on for quite a period of time. This is a stock, like I said, the story has ended, and it has ended in a very, very bad way. getting involved here at the lows is a very, very tricky trade unless you are trading off of smaller time frames. If you are using your daily charts and you say to yourself, okay, well, I want to be short against, you know, this pivot high here at 25. Or, you know, so just understand the risks associated with it. But the trade, the chart, everything's broken. It's been broken. You know, I think at this point, shorting and even being long a stock like this, you're trading for crumbs. You're looking for, you know, 2 to 3 day type trades, which is great if you can carve them out and carve them out nimbly. I know that Mark, my colleague Sperling, you know, was able to capitalize on this, you know, this two week up move the stock saw. But because it is a broken chart with a broken story, you know, you can see how fast it does end. So be very, very careful as you walk a very, very tight rope with this stock.
Let's answer College Trader, who asks, any advice for a new trader with limited capital who wants to trade like the guys at T3? And he also says, thanks so much for the daily educational videos.
Learn your craft. It's not about how much capital you have behind you. It's really about, do you understand your approach? Because, you know, as a trader, even I, when I started, you know, years ago doing this, my capital base was relatively modest. And you know, as I educated myself and as my career sort of developed, that capital base grew and grew and grew, as did with, you know, Red Dog and Mark and a lot of the guys here. So, you know, it's not necessarily you have to be super well capitalized. It's really more a question of, do you understand your craft? And this is probably the question I get the most, you know, as an educator here and a trader. Everybody thinks you have to have millions of dollars to make money in the market. You actually don't. You just have to be tactical, you have to understand risk, and you have to understand your craft. Most traders get into this with visions of grandeur. They want to trade, they want to make money, they want to do what Scott does. They want to, you know, they want to do what Mark does. They want to do this. But most don't ever really learn to do it for themselves. And it's like, you know, the story I always tell is, you know, if I didn't know how to paint a picture, and you gave me some brushes and some paints and said, here, paint me a picture. What do you think my picture would look like? I mean, it probably wouldn't be too pretty. And that's sort of the mentality that most novice traders go at this with. They think in terms of, you know, money and how much money they're going to make, when in reality, they have to think about, you know, maybe I should spend 6 months or a year to learn how to, you know, mix the paints and mix the colors and learn how to use the brushes and, you know, how to actually learn the craft. And how to think in terms of risk and reward and how to analyze charts and, you know, how to do time frame analysis and all these things. It's not just about how much money you have and you know, wanting to trade. That's usually the primary driver, but there has to be more to it than just that.
Solid advice. Let's talk Coors. Graybids asks, I'm long Coors from August 24th. How do I stay with the trade for a momentum or intermediate type trade?
Well, we can look at the chart here in Coors. I would say at this point, you know, the trade has happened. You know, the stock, you got to look at where you are and where you've come from. You know, Coors was a great IPO, you know, went into this monthly, you know, basing type process and has since broken out in a relatively fast way. Obviously, we had an earnings catalyst that drove us with a fairly substantial gap up. Being a buyer here at highs, you know, you can micro trade this. This is really more of a, you know, a short term trade. If you wanted to be long, you know, I would look to buy any short term pullback above this pivot. You know, so long as we stay above our last pivot low, which is about 52, it still represents a quality long situation as we are now into blue skies. What are blue skies? Well, we look at a weekly. Blue skies are blue sky breakouts. There's nothing to the left here. There's no prior resistance. This stock can go higher, this stock can go 60, 70, 80. I mean, there's really no way for a technician to say how high it can or will go. There are tools that I can, you know, implement here in terms of, you know, prior price. We can look at our extensions. You know, we can basically measure the first move the stock had up, you know, the depth of the pullback here. And we can look at, you know, the 100% extension. You know, 62, 63, 64 could be in the cards here. So it still represents a quality long, but the further this goes, you know, in a shorter amount of time, the more risk essentially you're going to take. So at this point, it represents a micro long. I still think there could be some follow through. You could see a move to 60, which is still percentage wise a really nice move. Stay long. Use your prior pivot low here at 52 as a stop.
Now, what about gold and silver? Ken asks, will gold and silver and oil continue their rallies?
That's a good question. I'm looking at the gold chart as we speak. My eyes are glancing all over. You know, gold is it's a tough long here. You're paying up. You know, the GLDs, and Scott's covered this, you know, 10,000 times between the precious metals, gold and silver. They gave really nice, you know, short-term trades. They broke out, you know, above this level here, you know, 2-3 weeks ago. Since that point, they've given you what I look to be this, you know, stair-step move, A, B, C up. You've now retraced a fair amount of this entire move down. So I think at this point, the move here is probably over. We've gone to the golden ratio. This is 618. Again, I'm showing some technical levels. A little bit of a tail down today. This needs time. This is not something you want to chase. You know, gold is a very overnight driven trade, as are most precious metals. You know, this is a trade that has to develop into another tradable base. If it's going to go higher, what's going to happen is you're going to see a high level base develop over the next, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks even. So give this trade some time. I think at this point, it's a little extended on the upside into the 618, probably due for a little bit of a short-term correction or pullback. You're probably better off being a buyer at lower prices or any short-term, you know, weakness. But give this trade. We can look at the SLVs, but, you know, the two are very, very similar. Again, very quick to the upside, you know, in a short amount of time. Generally, that represents, I think this trade's a little exhausted, you know, into some resistance over here. Time, patience. Give these charts a chance to redevelop, reset back up, you know, base, whatever you want to call it, before they give us, you know, better tactical, you know, risk situations.
Okay, we're going to take another quick commercial break, and we'll be back with Scott.
Hi, I'm Sean Hendelman of T3 Live, where we train, coach, and mentor traders in order to help you put your money to work with confidence. The T3 Live approach is a blueprint for you to recognize, adapt, and ultimately take advantage of different market conditions. To begin your training with T3 Live, we would like to offer you the opportunity to enroll in our free 30-day online home study course. Fill in your name and email address, and I'll see you on the other side.
We're back answering your questions live. Let's answer one from Ardo, who says, Scott, first, thank you and great macro call on Apple. Can you please talk about how you and Mark find swing trades?
Swing trades in Apple or just swing trades
in general? I think in general.
Okay. Typically, a swing trade is a trade that you want to stay with, a trade that you want to stay with longer, something that, you know, you feel like, you know, you like the name, you feel comfortable with it, and something that it depends on where you are in the market. If you're like you're bottoming for a swing trade, if it's a higher level base for a swing trade, and there are a lot of different examples. But the whole thing with a swing trade is you have identified risk. You say, I'm going to get involved at this level, and I'm going to only get out of it if something materially changes, and I'm going to ride it out. Because lots of times, I know for me, you know, I'll get involved in a trade because I have two accounts, a swing account and an active account. And sometimes I treat them both like an active account, and I don't make as much as I should because I don't let the swing trade, you know, develop further. And everyone knows the red dog reversal type of scenario. So I'm going to show you like two or three different scenarios I was just talking about today on the active, you know, on the virtual trade floor that turned out to be unbelievable swing trades that you would never have known it, but you didn't have to when you put it on. First one being Mosaic. Let's go back to that. Mosaic, horrendous stock in the first and second quarter. Horrendous. Okay, but remember Jill was saying we got to get ready for the third quarter because it's going to be a really big story. So, you know, first things first, here's where it had a swing trade short almost up here where, you know, you had this, it broke above and closed on its lows. So, you know, it failed at resistance. So some people got short versus this for a double top. And then if you trailed it and said, okay, once we go below this, which was just say 58.80, okay, you got short and said, okay, I'm not going to cover my short until either it stops me out at 59.80, which means you're wrong. That means it's not a double top, it continues, or, you know, something makes it look better. So here you go, you got short here, no reason to cover yet. Then all of a sudden came into support. So spot where you might have taken some off, but then at this point, never retraced more than a third of this move down. So I said, okay, this is a swing trade, I'm going to stay with it. And boom, all the way down to another level. And then finally, going into, I think this was earnings or some kind of news, you know, maybe you covered it because there was some kind of event there. But if you put it on short and said, I'm going to short it versus high here, you could have wrote a short with no pain, you know, all the way down to, you know, this lower level, which wound up being a really nice swing short. But then on the flip side, you know, a swing long, after a move from 60 all the way down to the lows here, okay, you had an 80-20 reversal bottom, okay, where it pushed through major support, I'm sorry. Yeah, you know, I'm not going to show you going all the way back this way, and reversed. So here you go. It made a new low, got people out who were using it as a stop, came back above, 80-20 trade galore. You know, just I'll even just use this price point right here. So just say you got in at 45.58, your stop right there is 44.45, or just say like so a dollar. So you put it right here, said I'm risking a dollar, stocks at 45.5, it came in from 60, let's see how long I could trail it as a swing trade for. Right away, you know, if you're a day trader, you made a nice day and a half move, you know, and this gave you no reason to get out because it closed near the high strong, so you saw demand there. Then on this gap up on day three, that's when I typically, if I'm holding something, if I got in this, like at this area, I wasn't sure if I did for compliance wise, that's typically where I would sell it. But as a swing trader, no need. Okay, and then what happened? It consolidated and went sideways, held the gap, still acts well. You're still in as a swing trade because it showed you no reason to get out of it. Okay, then it continued. You know, as an active trader, this would have been another active cash flow trade as you had your red dog reversal, you had a nice potent move to the upside, commitment to it by holding this gap, and then this is your, you know, downtrend that it crossed where you could have added here, added there, and then look, the three-day rule again. If you got involved for a shorter-term swing trade, because this is the type of swing trader that I like, third day I sell it. Okay, but you as a longer-term swing trader that has a job as a lawyer, doctor, teacher, social worker, whatever you are, and just trying to add cash flow to your life, okay, boom. You know, this could have been a day to get out because it, you know, it went below the previous 2 days low, so this was pretty potent. So maybe this was an area where you said, okay, it just rode its course. I just made 5 points in a swing trade. But really, this is where it broke out from. So it came back, didn't even get down there to retest it. So you could have stayed long. You know, so then from here, had another nice move, pulled in, gap up, look what happened over here, okay? Another type of rule where gap up, look, I talk about if you could hold the gap, there's pent-up momentum, never really filled this gap, tried here, didn't work, tried there, didn't work, you go sideways, still in this, look, oh, tried again, it's trying, oh no, what happened? It didn't happen. Then you had this day yesterday where it showed relative strength, remember we talked about relative strength? This showed it the ags yesterday. So really, still no reason, you know, to get out of your swing trade from the red dog low. You probably could have traded it using a tier system many times along the way if you had the time to, you know, a nice move above resistance where now it seems like it's in motion above a critical point and there's no reason why you can't, you know, fill this gap and continue up to 70. So if you were in a swing trade, it never gave you a reason to get out. Macy's did the same thing here too. You know, guys were looking for an entry in Macy's. I saw this the other day, so I wanted to just go over it. You know, here is your swing trade top, right? Here's where it pushed through, gave you an outside day, and failed. So some guys would have got short right there, we'll just say 41.74, okay, with a stop at the high of this day, which was, you know, 42.17, so just say about whatever that is, 40 cents. And then look at this fast move, you move down. Then maybe on this little, you know, reversal here, this potent three-day move, you covered it, you made nice money. Then if you were waiting for a swing trade long in Macy's because you thought, you know, you think it's, you know, it's a, you saw Target doing well, you saw Costco doing well, Walmart doing well, you figured maybe Macy's will get back in play. Look at that red dog reversal down there. After a big move lower, it tried to take out the lows, came back above, you could have bought right here. With the low is 32.70, so the way the strategy goes is pushes below, comes back above, that's your buy. Your stop is at 32.34, so 40 cents. You buy here, your stop is there, 40 cents risk. Look how quickly it moved. And then all of a sudden you're in a swing trade in Macy's and, you know, this could pay for a nice winter wardrobe, but I don't know if you shop in Macy's.
Well, being as Ardo complimented you on the macro call on Apple, let's answer Exhale, who wants to know where you see Apple going in the next few weeks.
In August, it was an awesome month. Apple, you know, first of all, with earnings, it came out, and sometimes, you know, you get a little lucky. We talked about, for some reason, my gut said, I'm not going to be long calls going into Apple's earnings because I just think that, who knows, maybe people are waiting for the new iPhone and it missed and it went lower. But then we weren't sure if, you know, it was priced in, so we looked at the charts. We said, okay, we're going to do gap analysis. Will this gap hold Apple, or will it, you know, ignore it and make it avoidable and be a great buying opportunity? So you go here with Apple, you know, this is right, you know, when that happened. Right here was the earnings, came down, hovered here for 2 days. And I tried to short it once or twice down here thinking maybe it can go lower. You know, it didn't happen. This was the trade into the gap, gave you 3 days. Remember I talked about the three-day rule? That's when you could have got out. And then, you know, reversed right here, but what did it do? It held higher. So this was really where I put my swing trade on for Apple, because I'm like, okay, big three-day move, commitment to it. You know, it traded below 602, okay, on this day, and came back above it and closed at 607. So that was my swing entry. And then from there, you could have held it all the way up to this Red Dog reversal and made for yourself almost 50 points pretty easily. Along the way, you know, you could have added a tier here when it broke out above this price level. If you're following me on my floor, you know 619 was a level. Then that Friday, remember when it broke above the 52-week high of 644? That was a nice trade into follow through. Now look where we are right here. Okay, we're holding higher. Let me get this out of the way. Here was that Friday Red Dog. This was a Samsung news, you know, and the gap didn't hold. So right there, you know, it wasn't pent up or as pent up. But if you think about the move that Apple just had, you know, it's not going to be a runaway train all the time. So here is your new swing trade entry. Your Red Dog reversal traded below 662 on this day. Put a low in at 657, $5 stop. And now all of a sudden, you know, you're like 13 points higher near the highs. I am long this. I've been long it since this day. I missed that day. I was out Labor Day weekend. I rebought when it went above that 668 area. And now it's above the 8 day. You know, a lot of guys are saying, Red Dog, Apple didn't make new highs with the market today. But again, look where it is. Look where it just came from. I think we're going to get that trade above 680. 680.87 is your next, you know, breakout type move. And I think it's coming. I think if you have risk, as a macro investor, I've been saying you have to be in this all year long. I've been saying you have to be in as a macro investor, I think, for the last 3 years. So that just goes to show you could be a stock picker. And as an intermediate trend trader, it's been great. And as an active trader intraday, you can make cash flow. So right here, I think you're going to get another, you know, at least now we have 678.29, which is today's high as a point of reference, you know, depending on what happens with the job number. And then you have here. So at this point, it breaks above this. Same way it broke above this, just say 644 area, or above this area. You know, it's going to be a nice cash flow trade, and I'm hoping it happens soon. And I want to be at my desk when it does, because I think it'll be a lot of fun and you can make a lot of money. It might be September 12th. You know, that's when they're doing their iPhone 5 launch. And you covered Amazon today, right?
I did.
And Amazon itself, just talking about Amazon, one of the go-to names. I had three go-to names in August: Amazon, Apple, and Google. I don't want to put you on the spot, but I saw, like, what'd you think of the product line? I think you did an interview with Jim.
Well, we did a preview with the Street's James Rogers about the Amazon event today, but that was before the conference.
Well, I think it acted pretty well. Take a look at the chart of Amazon, and you'll see it also has given you nice calculated trades, right? Here's your gap up, held the gap up the whole time. Here was the gap up to this earnings. This was when a lot of guys made money through 230, came back, retested. This is when you had the nice two-day trade. I think this is when I got back involved, did my little three-day rule, got out of it around there. And since then, it's been a trade slash methodical move and closed in new highs, and it's above these highs from over here. And it's rewarding investors, and it's trending higher, holding the 8 day. Typically, they try and sell an event, and they weren't able to sell Amazon in this event. Hopefully, the same thing goes for Apple.
All right. Well, you touched on Macy's before. Let's keep with the retail trend a little bit and talk Lulu. Market Picker says Lulu showed some bullish divergence today. Is this a name you might look to buy?
Lulu, you know, put in the bottom. We talk about swing trades, names that people like. And, you know, it got weaker. It did a breakout failure. We guys made actually money short. It looked like it was cooked, you know, or the spandex was too tight. And then we saw a reversal pattern, and that's when you could have gotten your swing trade. So you go back to Lulu here, and you will see, you know, pricing and timing. All right, here was the breakout failure, where if you were riding it for a long time, said, oh, look at this. You know, patterns repeat themselves. Remember I said if a gap holds, it usually trades in that direction. Well, here it gapped up, never filled it, continued in that direction, tried to break out and failed. This would have been your exit once it went above this, came back below this. So potentially, you know, you could have sold 76 when it came down here. and you could have been a buyer at, like, you know, when it went above this area around 62 or within this, you know, after holding the gap, whatever. So anyway, you know, from there it started trending down, and then right here you had a bit of a red dog reversal, right? 3 days down, broke below support. So right here, as a swing trade, your low is 53.19. This day right here, it went below it, stopped people out, got people short. You could have bought it here, put a stop in at 52.20, and then you saw a quick little move up, never gave you reason to get out, another move up, held higher all the way through, another nice trade right there, retested, continued, and this could have been a nice swing trade that you've been holding from whatever this is, 54 and change, all the way to almost 66. And at this point, it closed, or even more, you know, it just closed this gap, which sometimes you know, you kind of relax after it fills a gap, because it just gaps typically get filled. It's an air pocket. We, as traders, you love trading into a gap. So at this point, maybe you sell some, but this was a nice swing trade here, nice active trade right there, little flag type pattern as well. And, you know, it's been a nice move. So at this point, I would definitely trade them and trail them. That's what I say on the feed a lot. And right here, same thing.
All right. Well, speaking of red dog reversals, Rock says that Caterpillar did a red dog reversal 3 days ago. He asks, do you see the stock continuing this downtrend?
Okay. I'll take a look. Well, I guess it's just the wrong language. If something does a red dog reversal, that means it's doing a counter trend move and it's changing a trend. And all I know is Caterpillar has been junk this for the last 3 months, I'm sorry to say, if you're in it. So maybe guys that like Caterpillar are looking for some kind of calculated entry. And you know, here was, I guess, it started moving to the upside. This was, you know, your reversal right there, meaning that this counter trend trade to what has been a pretty disastrous move lower, you know, took place into the 200 day, pulled in. If you were looking for a long, you know, you see another small little reversal right here. So this is, if you got short here, this could have been your cover once it traded below and came above. And some people might have went long right there saying, okay, it's overdone. And now I would say if you're long this, it's got to get back above this with some authority. If you're longing for a swing, this is your stop. It is Caterpillar. People love to flock to it if markets are rallying. But this shows you how, look, you know, markets at historic highs. This is relative weak. Like, this shows you that you should not be in this. This is not above the 8 day. It's not above the 21 day. It's not in a strong sector. And there's so many better things out there. You know, look at the home builders, XHB. Pow, new highs above the 8 day, the 21 day, and the 50 day. Look at the RTX. Okay, we'll look at the RTH. Pow, new highs. Okay, stocks within this group going nuts. This is where you want to be. You don't have that much money. If you have money allocated to the spots that are showing you relative strength, above the 8, the 21, and the 50. Okay, another strong group. Look at just say the Qs. Pow. Is there any, did you watch Batman and Robin?
Yes.
Like, pow, gazoots,
go bam. Get that for the screen.
We got to get that. Parker, can we get like the Batman stuff that we had back in the day?
He's on it.
All right, he's on it. Anyway, go back to the Qs. You know, boom, boom. I didn't do that one. Another nice flag breakout. And a lot of tech stocks in there doing it. Okay, and this one broke above this resistance here. You know, and just goes to show you want to be in the right place as a, definitely as a macro investor. Yes, we can catch cute trades in Caterpillar. Like we do the trash, treasures for trash trade where, you know, like Facebook. I'll go right into that. Even is anyone talking about Facebook or LinkedIn on there?
We did have a question about Facebook. Actually, Nate was asking if Facebook found a floor at 19.
Okay. Well, I want to get into the concept of, you know, the difference between a macro equity holding or a macro, what's it could be a macro investment quality. You know, and we've been talking about LinkedIn as that type of quality, that it's been public for almost a year. Best, you know, new issues usually that come in the last few years, they're the ones that have the most explosive gains if they have the criteria. And now for the last three quarters, LinkedIn has impressed. You have a nice institutional consolidation going on. So LinkedIn has been something I've been saying you could trade, but you could hold as a macro investment. If you have five or six of them, this has the capabilities of 140, 160. You go to the chart here and you'll see this has now been public, you know, since it went public, what was this, way back when? Since May 9th, in 2011 of May. And it's been public for almost a year and a half, where now it's starting to break out. Institutions have been accumulating this. There's been times and places to get involved. The last place was after earnings, right? We talk about gaps. I'm going to show you another gap. Here is a gap after earnings, little follow through, but market wasn't ready. We didn't know we'd be breaking out in September, came in. It still held the majority of that earnings gap. Showed you pent up momentum. So remember we were talking on the stream, I like it versus level. I like it versus some. This level was actually This is 100 and a quarter. You know, I got a little bit more interesting when it went up here and started holding 104. And then right here was your entry. So like maybe tier one, tier two, and then all of a sudden, you know, it broke out. A lot of guys that weren't in it were able to make money once it cleared this 110, 112 area. We talked about that as being resistance. I think it was on the price point sheet that day also. And now look right back at the highs. So as a macro equity investor, you know, you could stick with this thing. I think that this thing's going to take out the highs here and go to probably 140. And I said that when it was in here. But now that we're here at resistance, I know I sold mine today because 10% in this type of move in a few days, you know, my 3-day rule, 1, 2, 3. I get out, I'd love to see this flag go sideways, show some commitment. Then perhaps we get a nice juicy trade above 120.42. And as a, you know, just say we want to say how to use a tier system. As if you were in tier two here, maybe you get back to tier one, you know, which you're going to hold because sometimes you sell a great stock and you never get back in. So if you're a macro equity investor, you stay, go sideways, and then you can perhaps make cash flow through this with the right setup to 124, and then you let it go for the rest of the move. But as far as Facebook was just the most mishandled, horrendous IPO, you know, from the start. And we have that art of trading an IPO in the first few days. And we say if it doesn't trade above the opening price, it's not worth your time. Well, it broke the actual IPO price, which made it run out of Dodge type trade. And since then, it tried to bottom 3-4 times, broke those pivots. And finally, yesterday, it was worth a look. The news came out that Zuckerberg's not going to sell for a year. You know, it's been finagled that it's actually a buyback, taking shares out of the float. I think it's 4%. So the shares, they sold at 38. They were allowed to buy back in 19. Good job. Anyway, so we talked about this yesterday in the recap where, you know, I got long for a day and a half trade. And so far, so good. And I'll show you why. You know, you had the gap up here. So let's go to the 8 minutes so you can see what happened there. This was your gap up. Okay, we talk about gaps. This is a different time frame. So here's your gap up on the news. I was not long Facebook into this gap overnight. It started going sideways, got long tier one right here. And then this was my tier two buy as it broke above this flag. Then all of a sudden, look at the 3-bar rule. It could happen intraday too. 1, 2, 3. Sold to get back to like tier one. And then I held tier one the entire time. And then today, you know, actually, I think I may have took a little bit more overnight. It gapped up above prior resistance and didn't look back. I think I tweeted that I sold some over 19. And now I took a little bit overnight, not a lot, but look what happened here. It actually came back, retested, didn't break this. So it didn't break this or it didn't fill this gap. So I said, I'm going to stay with it as a swing trade. And who knows, maybe it's the bottom. At this point, all it is a great 2-day trade with a tactical strategy that you could learn in the active trade, of course. And then also as a swing trade, this could be your swing trade. You could say, I'm going to hold Facebook forever unless it breaks 18.18. Or until it shows you something different. Now, if you go to the daily chart one more time, you know, you do have the moving average right here. So it could get to 21 and maybe with a little excitement, 22.45. So it could be a nice little counter trend trade in a stock that's been annihilated, but you don't have to know that yet.
Well, time flies when you're having fun, because that's all the time that we have for today. That's it. Any closing thoughts?
Watch the price action. You know, for the last month, we've been seeing people paraded on TV saying the equity space is dead, stocks are dead, you know, lost generation. I don't buy it. It's just people who didn't navigate the markets correctly. I still think that people are educating themselves. Instead of using a broker, they're using an Ameritrade, an E-Trade, a Lightspeed, a Schwab, whatever it is, you know, account, and they're learning how to push the buttons themselves to get accountability. You know, we just broke out to 4.5-year highs in the S&P, I think 12-year highs in the NASDAQ. You know, so there is opportunity if you learn how to look for it. You know, it's not, they don't hand it out on trees and they don't, you know, give it away at Walmart, which was a great stock this year, my retail stock of the year. What a great plug that was.
Gotta get that plug.
Maybe
in.
Home Depot. Home Depot was 2 years ago, but if you were a swing trader and you held it, you're really doing good. And what was the stock of this year? Oh, Google. We didn't talk about Google. So I just want, before we close up, look at Googie. Googie, Googie, Googie. You know, there you go. Pow. Right after earnings started acting really well, we talked about 620. Since then, hugging the 8-day, this was that gap down on the Samsung news. We said to buy it, you know, or look to see if it holds it, then buy it. You could have bought it then above this. Another nice move. Carry from T3 had it as a nice bull flag, closed really well. You know, this stock was my high beta tech stock pick of the year this year because of this monthly chart, because of the fact that it hasn't made a historic high since what, 2007. And now it looks like it's on its way. Here it was just search. Now it's got like 4 or 5 different businesses. So anyway, So sorry for the shameless plug, but we didn't talk about Google. I think it's still good. I still think as a macro equity investor, you hold on, and at some point it's going to be testing 747. So to wrap it up, because I'm a little, you know, diarrhea of the mouth tonight, which I apologize, just know your time frame. Put the time in to educate yourself, and if you do that, I think that the market's very rewarding. A lot of people are probably like, oh my God, well, how are we at four-year highs? Everyone's doomsdaying out there. I thought Europe was falling apart. I thought Greece was going back to the drachma. I thought that, you know, the fiscal cliff was going to, you know, give me a haircut or whatever it is. You know what? Don't look at the media. Don't look at the, you know, I'm a media guy too. Don't just pay attention to the action of the stocks. They tell a different story than what you read in the paper you see on TV. And hopefully you learn how to read that story, because that's the story that can't lie, because price action doesn't lie.
And hopefully we helped you guys out tonight, and meet us right back here next Thursday. Have a great night.